Rosell, speaking of sports.
You are listening to The Cheap Seats.
Who are these guys?
On Twitter at TCS Willis MSP Betterman. Spreaker and iHeartRadio.
Here is Steve and Steve.
Oh my God. They found me. I don't know how, but they found me.
Ah boy, here we go.
Good afternoon, everybody. You are tuned in to the one, the only, the Cheap Seats. I'm your host, Steve Willis, alongside me, Captain America.
I am going to go watch Captain America.
He is the great American hero.
That is right.
NIU's very own Steve Dennerman. How are you, sir?
I am doing great. Now, are you part of Team Cap? Or are you part of Team Iron Man?
You know what? Honestly,
You brought it up. I love the movie.
Of course, Captain America. It's in theaters now.
It just came out last night.
Yep. Captain America.
Are you
going to
see it this weekend?
I am not. It is Mother's Day weekend. I'm probably going to save that, like I do everything else. Promise myself that I'm going to go watch it and then never watch it.
I am actually. My daughter came back in town, and she's the one that goes to the movies with me.
Uh-huh.
My wife does not like going to movies, and you know the best Mother's Day present we give to her is get the heck out of the house and let her have some peace of mind and without us there.
Which actually is a grand idea.
It is. So we're actually going to do that tomorrow night. So we're going to go watch that movie. So I am all right now. I'm all Team Iron Man. I like Iron Man. I like Captain America. I hate to see him fight, but hey.
I love the brashness of Iron Man.
Yes.
He's kinda cocky.
He's smart. I mean, he's got a nice wit, kind of like me. No.
That's what I was going to say. It reminds me exactly of me. But honestly, though, I like all.
I do too.
Of the Marvel characters, always have.
Yep.
And so it's going to be an interesting movie, I think. I'm not really going to be like rooting for one side or the other.
Now speaking of superheroes, there was a team of superheroes out there this afternoon.
There was,
and
I tell you, it has just
been unbelievable. And unless you've been under a rock, you have no idea what we're talking about. And of course, you're sporting the colors. You're sporting the jersey today.
That is the 22-6 now. Chicago Cubs.
That is right. I mean,
best start since before their World Series runs in 1907 and 1908.
When were those again?
1907 and 1908.
I tell you, it is so exciting, as a Cubs fan to just be a part of this. And we talked a little bit earlier that, and I know Bill brought up this could be like a Golden State run. And that's what they're – I mean, they're right now, they're just – today they've been faced off with basically the second best team in baseball, which is the Washington Nationals.
I really like the idea of generating that kind of excitement. I still say it is way too early to start talking about anything like this.
So nice to even have that opportunity to think about it.
It really is.
And for all of us longtime suffering Cub fans that sat there and received the stink eye and everything else from all those Cardinal fans and, the gloating
and
everything.
Or even the guys from across town.
Yes,
even the guys from the south side.
Yes, hey, we won ours back in 85. Yeah, right, 85. Remember way back when? Yes, we can even go back further. So how's that? 1907, we sure can. But, it's nice to be able to look at your baseball team and see what they're doing. And not to be the butt of jokes, because how long have we been the butt of jokes? Wait till next year.
Long time.
Wait till next year began on March 30th. Mm. The season began March 31st.
Right.
We're so used to that. We were already saying wait till next year before spring training was over.
Right.
This year now, 22-6. Unbelievable.
And one of the things that we talked about before the show started that I think is the most amazing and what I think really speaks about how powerful this team actually is the fact that they are doing it in any facet you could possibly imagine. If you need a pitcher's duel, you have three pitchers that can go nine innings and offer up two or fewer hits. If you have a warm day, the wind's blowing out, and you need home runs, You have power across the entire lineup. If you need to play small ball, you have fast guys, good contact guys, guys that are good with the double steal, the hit and run, sacrifice. They are capable of putting together a strategy to generate runs every inning. It doesn't matter who is up. Somebody can generate a run every inning, and this is how they've been winning games. It's one of the ways you have to win games early, especially if you play in a cold weather city like a Chicago or a Boston or a New York, where you have to generate runs early because you don't have the luxury of the warm air and right. the warm conditions to get that ball to travel. And it is just a nasty, nasty springtime in the Chicago area right now.
It's been horrible.
And they are making the most of it. The opposing teams that are coming in, they're not ready to play in those conditions. Nope. The Cubs are. They're ready to do it. Now that it's starting to get warm, we're going to see a few – I think we're going to see a few games that are going to be a little bit closer.
I think we're going to see a lot more high-scoring games, too.
I really do. And I think the Cubs are going to be beneficiaries of – all that power in the lineup. Now, obviously, no Kyle Schwarber. Everybody kind of shrugged at that at first. It wasn't a five-alarm fire it would have been in years past.
Oh, no.
Now we're talking about, okay, well, Anthony Rizzo, we got him. You know,
You plug in Soler. Plug in Baez. You bring out LaStella. I mean,
Caesar.
Yeah, I mean, you talk about these guys that they're just bringing in, and the neat thing is, as you brought, they have three pitchers. The other two pitchers, one is 3-1, the other one's 4-0.
Right.
So I mean, your 4 and 5 pitchers are really contributing right now.
Right.
And the thing that I think is really impressive about this team right now is it's not been one batter. It's not been one person being hot. I mean, right now Rizzo's hot, but you know what? So is Zobrist. Zobrist hit 2 more home runs today. You know, and then all of a sudden you have LaStella go off. Caesar went off that grand slam last week. Fowler was hot early in the season. Now he's cooled off a little bit. He's still batting over 300.
Right.
But I mean, we're starting to see Bryant come in. We're starting to see Ross come. I mean, you're seeing these guys really start to hit. Baez, to me, has just been unbelievable this last week, watching him hit, you know, batting about 340, 350. But his defense, did you see the play he did the other day, the short roller where he came up, going off the field, the throw across his body, nailed the guy first?
Yes.
I mean, that's something that you just go, wow. That is a defensive play.
The infield defense for the Chicago Cubs this year
so far
has been as good as I have ever seen in my entire life. And I've been watching baseball since I was a young man.
The thing is, I go back a little bit further to the Kessinger and Banks in the middle and Santo and Billy Williams at first, and that was a damn good infield.
Right. Well, I said my life, not yours.
Yeah.
You're talking about when my father was a child. I'm just saying.
Now, you don't have to age me so much there, Steve. You young whippersnapper over there.
But, you know, it's so much fun, you know, though. You know, and then I think the next game after Baez made that great play, I watched Addison Russell make a throw to second into right field. And you just go, well, where did that come from? But overall, I mean, the defense, you're watching these kids, and it's hard to remember that these kids are all 24 and under. Your old men, I mean, Wirzel's 26. Now Haywood is what, 25?
He's 25 or 26. I think he's going to be 26 here.
I mean, your old man here is Ross and Zobrist. Those are your old men.
Well, you can tell when you see Ross.
I know,
too,
with the gray
he's standing
in his
around
beard,
the rest of these guys. Yeah, he's got the salt and pepper beard going on.
I thought it was real neat here in the preseason because this is going to be Ross's last year. He already said, and they've basically made it the grandpa tour. You know, they brought him a little wheelchair, like a motorized little wheelchair scooter for him, and they did all these old things. And that's baseball. But that's the fun thing about this team. And you know, this week we had our first dress up weekend, our first dress-up road trip.
Boy, did you see some of those suits?
I tell you, that is what I love about Joe Madden. Joe Madden knows how to keep a team light, but they came out in some of those suits, and it's just, you're watching, there can't be anything worse than that. Okay. Look at that one.
I got to tell you, I'd have totally rocked about 3 or 4 of those.
Oh, there were some good, there were some nice suits.
There was this one, it was kind of this, it kind of looked like, if you took a pair of Chuck, like plaid Chuck Taylors, and made an entire suit out of it. I think Dexter Fowler was wearing it. Yeah, it was.
Was it Bryant that had the little hat with his?
Yes, that was so cool. But I totally rocked every one of those. Not the camo, because I don't do camo.
Right. The thing is, last week when we talked about how, you know, the Cubs had been, you know, doing it early and doing against not the greatest teams in the league. They were doing what a good team is supposed to do. They're supposed to take these teams and beat up on them. But since then, they took three from Pittsburgh. They've now taken two from Washington. Those aren't your run-of-the-mill teams.
Now, let me tell you something about the significance of beating Pittsburgh. And it wasn't just that they beat them.
They beat them at
PNC Park. They swept them, and they beat them handily in every game. Yep. That is the number two team in your division, and you just took them to the woodshed, boy, 3 days in a row.
In their home park.
Right in their own backyard. That is a sign of a team that understands the gravity of where they are.
But I'll even take it one. I'll take it one step further. It's very easy after doing that to have a letdown, especially when you have the second best team in your league come to town.
Yeah,
and they have not. They whomped them the first night. Today it was a little bit closer, but it was 7-2. It ended up 8-6. But they had them, you know, by a large margin.
Right,
and this is something that, you know, it's really. You know, it's interesting to see a team do this, and it's really telling. When you come off a big series, you have a big road win like that, it's so easy to have that letdown, especially they had to travel from Pittsburgh back to Chicago to play that game.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you're coming off this whole big road trip, and then, you know, hey, we went in there. It was very emotional because, remember, they had to beat Pittsburgh last year just to get into the series. That was their play-in game, basically.
Right. And you could tell the emotion. Oh yeah. Seventh and eighth.
It was the first game where they had the two guys hit and they had the benches clear.
Well, and then in the third game of that series, you know, the umpire's throwing out warnings left and right. So I mean, you could tell there was a lot of motion in that series already. There was a lot of bad blood from
easy to have a letdown after that.
Right.
But to come back and do what they did and win 7-2 that first game, I mean, that was something. And the thing is to keep in mind is you've won the first two. You got two more to go. Arrieta's starting one of those games. He's starting on Sunday.
And when you look at the pitchers so far in this series, looking, for example, today.
You took out Scherzer.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, you took out the former Cy Young Award winner from Washington, you know, Max Scherzer.
Right.
And you belted him. You belted him for seven runs.
Right. We're not talking about, you know, your run-of-the-mill.
Yeah. I'm going up against
the best pitchers in the National League right now.
I'm going up against Ron Jones. Who? Ron Jones. You remember him? No, this is Max Scherzer, former Cy Young Award winner.
Mopping floors.
I know.
Yeah.
No, I mean, you know, and that's it. They're going. These are good pitchers.
Yeah, absolutely.
These are not your run-of-the-mill pitchers. Now tomorrow, I believe, who goes tomorrow? Hamels.
I believe it's going to be Hamels,
and I'm not sure who's going for Washington, but I know Arrieta is going on Sunday. And that should be, you know, one hell of a matchup there. Let me see if I can find I had him up here. Tomorrow it is going to be Gio Gonzalez, another former Cy Young Award winner, against Hamels. And then on Sunday you've got, let me see if I can find it here, Rourke versus Arrieta. How about Arrieta? Only 6-0 with an ERA under 1.
Yeah, I know.
When
you have a pitcher who is so dominant that he's going into a game, and at most pitchers they go into the game like, hey, man, if you can only allow like one run in 6-7 innings, that'd be great. With Arrieta, it went from, okay, well, let's see if he can not allow a run through 5-6. Okay, well, let's see, complete game.
Yeah.
Okay. Now it's complete game shutout. Oh, now it's complete game no hit.
See, I mean, literally,
the first time he walks a guy, it's like,
See, and I don't.
We're looking for a perfect game out of him
see,
now.
See, I don't mind right now if he goes 6 innings, he has given up one or no runs. He shut him out. Is to get him out and save some of those innings for later. Right. I have no problem. You know, unless he's got a no-hitter or one-hitter going, something like that, he's just in a groove, let him go. But I have no problem. I mean, the other day they pulled him out, what, after six innings? He had a shutout going. He walked a couple of guys, and they were up, like, I think, 6 or 7 to nothing. They just pulled him out and let the bullpen finish it. But, I mean, you know, the thing is that, you know, save some of those innings. Why not?
Right.
You know, he's put them in the position to win, but also you got to let your bullpen work too. And the thing is with these Cubs pitchers, the bullpen has not gotten a lot of work. They really have not. You know, Rondon right now, you've played 28 games. You've won 22. How many saves on a normal team would he have? 10, 11?
Yeah, something like that.
He's got 5. That's all they've had to use him because the starting pitching has been that good and the offense has been that good. You know, they have outscored their opponents now over 90 runs.
I was actually just getting ready to get to that. And here is a very interesting thing that I found earlier, and I wanted to show this to you. When you look at teams that can generate runs,
right?
One of the key stats is on base percentage. Mm-hmm. How many times can you get on base when you're coming up to the plate? All right. So now we're just taking the hits out of it. Just being able to take walks just, and everything.
Whatever you get on.
So
whatever
however you get on. All right. What's a decent on base percentage? Usually about 335, well, any,
I think right now you're seeing anywhere about 350 and above.
Okay, 350 and above. So we'll take the 350 mark. All right. Let me just take a wild guess at how many Chicago Cubs, how many Cubs on the 25, 28-man roster, 26-man roster, on how many Chicago Cubs have an on-base percentage of 350 or better?
Wow. You know, and the thing
wild
is,
guess. Just take a wild
you know,
guess.
Me, I would say right now, 9.
How about 11?
11.
11.
I mean, a team is happy to have maybe 3 or 4 guys.
11 guys.
And the thing is I said 9 because just what they've done, when you take a look at that percentage of outscoring your opponent by 90 runs, that means you're getting on base, you're doing a lot of things. So I figure, well, I'm starting to go through the lineup. I go, well, that guy had, you know, Fowler, now, he's batting over 330, so 350, yes, I would say that. And
Now, I will tell you this. If you take guys that have had less than 10 at-bats out, now you're at 8.
Okay.
But still, I mean, when you look at just looking at the guys that are even close, like, Javier Baez is 340. You know, his on-base percentage, and, that's at 16 at-bats. But, I mean, look at this. We're talking, you know, Addison Russell, 352 at 25 at-bats, and then Chris Bryant, Zobrist, Rizzo, Scherzer, Fowler.
Lestella's
got under 20, but all those guys have over 20 at-bats, almost 30 at-bats, and they're all 455, 441, 420, 409.
That's unbelievable. As a team, what are they doing?
That is ridiculous.
What's their on-base percentage as a team?
Well, I have the
individual
stats.
But does it add it up at the bottom? Here. If you go to the bottom, does it?
Nope.
No, it won't. Okay.
Nope. I can pull it up by... Okay. By the
because that would be interesting team. To see where do they compare in the league with some of the other teams.
Well, if you want to go on base percentage, like compared to everybody else in the major leagues, they're behind the Pittsburgh Pirates by 2/100ths of a point. 366 by the Pirates, 364 by the Cubs.
2/100ths of a percent.
2/100ths of a percent. And then the Giants are behind them at 350. Wow. Right at that watermark that you talked about. So they're number 2 in the league.
Well, I'm looking there right now, and out of the top 10, what do you got, like 7 National League teams?
Yeah. Yeah, 7. Eight out of the top 10. Yeah, because the Brewers snuck in there at 9.
No, there's 3. 7. You got the Boston, Baltimore, and Seattle.
Oh, okay, yeah. I didn't see 3, Seattle, so 7.
So 7 out of the 10 are the National League.
Right, yeah.
And that's the non-designated hitter league.
Right. Isn't that crazy? That's a crazy stat.
Well, you know, the nice thing is you take a look at the Cubs pitching,
right,
and they're hitting. I mean, I think the pitchers have 2 or 3 home runs already.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, so they've been in on the game also.
Yeah, like designated hitter. We don't need one of those.
But it's been real neat so far. And yes, we have a very small sample size. We've got 28 games.
Right.
It's 162, you know, season. So
right. So
you
we know, got you, a long you,
oh, yes.
time ago.
Oh yeah, you still got 136 games left.
Right.
Or 134 games left. So I mean, you still have.
A long
you know, this
way
is
go.
Like what 1/7 of your season right now.
Right.
But 1/7 of your season, you got a winning percent over 750.
If you want to put it like
I'll take it.
If you want to put it like in NFL terms, they played two games.
Well, put it this way: if they went, they're 22 and 6 right now, right?
Mm-hmm.
You got 136 games left.
Mm-hmm.
If you go 500, that's 68. Okay, you get 90 wins.
Yeah.
If they go 500 the rest of the year, just 500.
That's 90 wins.
They've got 90 wins.
That's ridiculous.
Isn't it, though?
That's enough.
90
that,
wins.
That is enough to win you
a division.
A division,
yes.
In normal circumstances.
And that's just going 500. That gives you an idea how crazy this start has been.
And how good
yeah.
this start has been.
But, you know, and the thing is that when we talk about the Cubs, go over to the American League. What's the hottest team over there right now?
White Sox.
That's right. Mm-hmm. The White Sox and the Red Sox.
Yes, sir.
You know, and they're battling it right now. This is a weekend. If you are in Chicago and you are not going to a game, shame on you. Because you've got
right.
both the division-leading Cubs and the division-leading White Sox at home the same weekend. What a hell of a time that would have been today if you went to the afternoon game.
Oh,
and then
yeah.
and you got your tickets tonight to go watch the White Sox play the Red Sox. So, I mean, that is just unbelievable.
Right. Yeah, you could not be any happier right now about baseball in Chicago, especially because, you know, the Bulls have done nothing in the NBA
no.
this year.
The
so
Bears have done nothing. The Blackhawks
yeah,
are out.
Anything.
Yeah.
yeah, Blackhawks are done. So, I mean, you know, the great savior is now, you know, the Cubs and the Sox. So the
right.
North side and the South side have something to be incredibly proud of right now.
Oh, no kidding.
And I'm totally excited, dude. I cannot wait to see how the rest of the season plays out. You know, I mean, I don't want the summer to, like, come and go really quickly.
No.
But man, I will enjoy the way it plays out. Now, hey, just a reminder, friends and neighbors.
It
is Mother's Day weekend. So, first of all, if you haven't gotten on the phone and made plans with your mom for Mother's Day, shame on you. I shouldn't be disrespectful if your mom is still around. You know, I mean, people,
right.
you know,
right.
some people have lost theirs, but my mom is, and we've already talked. We're going to be doing something later on.
Cool.
When Mother's Day calms down a little bit. But we actually have a little something on the Facebook page posted up a little while ago. We want to hear your mom sports stories, your best mom sports story. And what that is, like, say your mom, you know, driving the kids to soccer practice or something. If you got a funny story or a neat story or a little something, or if you're an athlete, former athlete, and your mom did a lot to help support you while you were, you know, doing what you wanted to do, what you loved to do, I want to hear the story. Go
yes.
on the page. Go on the page. Give
we'll
us the story. And we will read them on air. So, and we'll look. We'll see any. We will get to them. If not, we'll repost them, you know, online if we don't see any by the end of the show. We will repost what we see online. So
one big thing, July 25th through the 28th, what are you doing? It's a Monday through Thursday. White Sox Cubs. they play two at the White Sox, then two at the Cubs. So
two at Wrigley.
Yep, four games right back-to-back.
Wow.
I mean, that's how they're doing it this year. So they'll play Monday and Tuesday at the Cell. Wednesday and Thursday at Wrigley. I think that's a road trip right there. That's got to be a road trip.
That does sound fun.
Can you imagine those tickets will be going for?
I can only
especially
imagine.
If both these teams stay as hot as they are.
All I'm saying is that you might want to look for a pay raise.
There you go. There you go.
That or sell a few pints of blood or something. I don't know.
My plasma will be going out yeah. every other week.
All right. And with that note, we're going to get Detterman bandaged up.
There
and
you
we'll
go.
Be back here in just
a
little bit.
I need to drink some more fluids.
Just on the other side of this, the NBA playoffs going strong. The Cavaliers are making a case for why they may end up winning it all. I'm going to tell you a little bit about that just on the other side of this. Listen to the Cheap Seats on XCRS Radio.
Broadcasting to the four corners of the earth, Michiana Edge, every Sunday night, 7 p.m., XCRSradio.com.
You stick with it, and you're passionate about it, you'll get better.
Climb aboard Starship Comedy and join co-hosts Adam Nielsen and...
your beloved comedian, Colton Colt.
As we boldly go where no internet radio team from Michiana has gone before.
I am a legend from the future.
We will travel to the comedy underworld so you will know where's the show.
I miss when drinking was fun, man. You know what I mean? Like, before it was like a problem.
If it's funny or it's cool, we will cover it. Hey. See what I did there?
I was sent from space.
Dude, that's gold.
Just like my jokes.
Your mama must be so proud.
Why can't you love me?
Tune in Wednesday night at 6 p.m. for Through the Deep Trash with Bill McDonald.
We want to welcome you back to XCRS Radio, Through the Deep Trash show tonight, and we're traveling down the highway here. Strap on your helmet, board the short bus. It's going to be a rough ride. You're traveling the deep tracks tonight with Mr. Bill. We're in
Through the Deep Track.
And want to wish him a happy birthday. We're going to carry on now with a song from the Rolling Stones. And actually, it was this week. Huge and a happy birthday this week. He's turned 62 this week. And we're going to finish out the evening with a track here, the third track from the album. Is
Wednesday nights at 6, only on The X, XCRSradio.com. Through the Deep Tracks.
From all of the games on our big screens to the best collection of memorabilia from your favorite sports greats, Rock Sports Bar and Grill in downtown Mishawaka has you covered. Our menu features something for everyone. Amazing sandwiches and wraps, and the best burgers around, including the Rockstar Overdose. 2 half-pound patties served with bacon, cheddar cheese, and piled high with French fries. Like us on Facebook to check out our daily food and drink specials that are sure to be great on your gut and easy on your wallet. We've got you covered between game days, too. Wednesday night is trivia night, where you can match wits with your buddies for great prizes. And every weekend, Rocks features great music from some of Michiana's finest artists. Come see why there's no better place to get your fan fix than Rocks Sports Bar and Grill in the Yorktown Center building in downtown Mishawaka. For those who come to Rocks, we salute you.
Where do you go when you're looking for great food, a cold drink, and some of the best local live music? I go to the Phoenix, located on the corner of Lincoln Way and Main Street in historic downtown Mishawaka. Thursday nights, it's open jam with $2 well drinks. Friday and Saturdays, there's always live music with no cover charge. Great food, cheap drinks, excellent service. The place to be is the Phoenix.
Hi, this is Paul Erdman, and you're listening to XCRS Radio.
And we are back to Cheap Seats on XCRS Radio, brought to you by State Farm Insurance. Make sure you check, double check, triple check, but definitely double check everything when you're getting ready to go out on your spring and summer vacations. Double check the air in your tires, double check the wardrobe, and make sure that you are ready to rock and roll.
There are no malfunctions.
That's right. But you should also double-check your car insurance. Make sure you're getting the best discounts possible and the best coverage available. And you can do that right from State Farm's website. Just go to statefarm.com. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there. State Farm, proud sponsor of XCRS Radio and Major League Baseball. So, Steve-O.
Yes, Steve-O.
So, as you can tell...
I didn't know where to go. Steve-O.
What the hell?
When have you ever called me Steve-O?
I don't know. It just felt right. Okay. Why you gotta ruin the moment, though?
Well, you know, I hear that quite often about ruin the moment. So I'm used to it, I think.
Detterman the show
killer.
That's
right. No, anyways, as you were saying.
I was wondering why your nickname was Showstopper. I just figured it out.
No, it's just SS. The SS Detterman.
Yeah, there you go. So check this out. Your boy was sick this week.
Yes.
Did you hear about that?
No. Which one?
Me.
Which boy? Oh, you were sick. Yes,
me. Your boy. Dude that's sitting right here next to you doing the show with you.
Yes, you were, because you went down with some strep throat.
Man, that was rough.
And the thing is who was one of the first ones to reach out with you and find out how you were? Who reached out to you? Seriously.
I
did. I texted you and asked how you were.
Yes, you did.
I asked about the show to make sure that you were doing what you should do to be ready for it, and you were.
Yes, you did.
Okay. So, I was very concerned when I saw that.
And I must say, and this is the thing that really surprised me.
Yes.
I'm 100%.
Yes, you are.
The voice is right where it needs to be.
That's right.
I don't sound any different.
No, I was amazed. Actually, I think you sound better, because there's sometimes you come in here with that, you know, that crap in your throat from allergies and things like that.
This is true.
And the thing is today you are, you're perfect.
Yeah, clear as a bell.
Yes.
I couldn't believe it, actually.
Maybe you need to get strep every week.
I don't know, but I'm going to tell you this. I'll tell you right now.
No, you don't.
I wouldn't wish it on anybody.
No, I've had it before.
Yeah, it's horrible. No,
it is.
But literally, there was.
Yes.
Yeah. Kind of a lot like that.
Oh yeah.
There were literally points in time that I honestly was scared that I couldn't even. I wasn't going to be able to breathe. My throat was like almost swollen shut.
Oh, I bet. I'm glad. And like I said, I was one of the first ones to reach out to you when I first saw that.
Right.
And you put the Facebook post out there, and it's very easy for people to follow up with a Facebook comment.
Oh yeah.
I texted you actually. I did not go to the Facebook route. I texted directly to you to find out how you were doing.
Yeah. I'm
a concerned co-host.
I'm literally about to drop this microphone and start hugging you
right
now.
Well, you should.
You're my bro, man. I appreciate it. No. But I brought all this up just to point out the fact that couple of days sick, I'm right back in the
game. Yes, you are.
I'm ready to do this thing. You know, I'd have came here 50%. I'd have came here 80%. You know why?
Because you are a gamer.
Not only am I a gamer, I don't like to be out of practice. I don't like to walk away. I don't like to sit out.
I know where we're going now.
I don't like to sit on. I don't like to chance coming back in and stumbling my way through a show or two and, trying to.
Or a playoff game
or something like that.
Series or anything like that. Yeah.
And I thought about this, and I thought about what I was doing, and I thought to myself that this is what Steve Kerr should be doing to Steph Curry right now. This is what he should be doing. I understand that, okay, you're not really up against the top talent in the West right now. All right. You are winning your series handily right now. I get it. You have plenty of talent on that Golden State team.
But you have to remember history too. Remember, he hurt himself
right
prior to the first playoff series.
Right.
They brought him back a little bit. You know, they brought him back after a little bit. Like you're saying, you know, get back in there. What'd he do? In a series that meant nothing, because the Warriors were going to womp them anyway. He got hurt worse.
Right.
Now, if you bring him back again, and this is what we talked about a little bit, during the break. If you bring back Steph Curry now in a series that I don't see them not winning this one 4-1 at the worst, what if you take that chance of when you need to go against San Antonio, you do not have a healthy Steph Curry? You have someone that gets hurt in a series that you're winning 4-1. And now maybe, and you've seen this from other teams. We watched the LA Clippers get decimated. You lose Paul, you lose Blake Griffin for the series.
There's a huge difference.
No, there isn't, because all it takes is one play.
No.
Ask Paul George about one play coming down and breaking your leg in three pieces.
Right. There is a huge difference because of the two teams that we're referring to. You're talking about the Clippers, who the Clippers are two guys. The Clippers are Blake Griffin and Chris Paul.
Yes,
that's
they
it.
Are.
That's it. It's over. after that. Golden State's bench is so deep that if something happens and Steph Curry were to be hurt and done, they're still a viable team.
And that's what they're doing. That's what they're doing right now. But why do you need to do that before the San Antonio series?
Here's why.
Okay.
Here's why. Steph Curry is a shooter.
Right.
All right. Everything.
The
he is
best
a shooter.
Shooter.
All right. You have lived a life of Steph Curry playing in this offense, scoring 35% mm-hmm. of the points, shooting 60% from the floor every night. If he comes back, and I'm not saying he's going to come back ice cold, but if he comes back, there's a big difference between 35% of your offense being run through Steph Curry and him only shooting 30% from the floor versus 60%. Him only making 10% of his threes versus making 70% of his threes.
I'm not saying that necessarily will happen.
I'm not saying it will happen, but I'm saying even one game, especially if it were to be critical against a San Antonio Spurs team or something like that,
you're talking the loss
of home field advantage at that point, or home court advantage at that point. Now, here's the other aspect of this. 35% of your offense being run through Steph Curry, he goes out, that offense is now divided up amongst the rest of the team. He comes back in, now everybody's got to make play adjustments. Now everybody's got to be adjusted to back to the way that it was.
And I disagree with you.
If Curry's taking shots that other guys were ready for, and other guys were playing, and you know, or other guys were being prepped for in the games before, now all of a sudden, oh, hey, now we're going to go back to the same offense. You all it takes in a seven-game series against a team like San Antonio or a team like Oklahoma City, or now we're even talking possibly a team like the Cavaliers, and you lay an egg in game one, that's not good. This is not – we're not talking playing Toronto.
We're not talking
playing Washington. We're not talking playing Memphis. We're talking – the three best teams in the NBA that aren't named the Golden State Warriors.
And I understand that, but I disagree with you because during this time period, you're letting Steph Curry get 100%. But in the same vein, is you're letting other people get the opportunity to take shots that they haven't been taking, to get some confidence in, and also seeing that they can win the game without Steph Curry there. They're getting the confidence that you cannot replace. They're getting the confidence you cannot get. You know, if Steph Curry's in there, it's like, okay, hey, Steph scored 35 points. You know, I did my 10 points. I did my 12 points. Well, now Steph's out. You bring Sean Livingston in. He's going from scoring 6 points to 18 points. Talk about the confidence that Sean Livingston is getting right now by coming in and doing that. Talk about the confidence that the other members of this team know that if Steph Curry is not there, that they do have the ability to still score at will. They have the ability to still have the same good defense that they've had before, stellar defense. Now add Steph Curry in there. Now what you're doing is you're bringing in someone that doesn't have to run the whole damn show by himself. And that's what it seemed like for a while. All last year was all Steph Curry. This year they start adding the team. Right now you're adding more of the team. Plus, you're taking the risk away from losing Steph Curry for the whole damn rest of the season and still making sure that you have him when you do play those games.
You're not wrong.
I know that.
But, listen, I'm going to start there. You're not wrong. Okay. I'm not saying at any point that I disagree with you.
That wasn't me.
I think it's the fan underneath buzzing. Anyhow, it's not a big deal.
That's okay. It's just a fan. It's technical difficulties here at the studio.
It's with us. The hamster needs to be fed, so it's all good. Hey, no, look.
So anyway.
Check this out. All right. I'm not saying that you're wrong at all.
Okay.
All right. But what I am saying is this. All it takes is to have that one egg for one of these three really good teams to turn it around and make you pay and ultimately pay by getting knocked out of the playoffs. I am not saying that, you know, Yeah, I know it sounds like I'm calling Golden State a house of cards right now, and I'm not. I'm totally not. All right? But all I'm saying is that one game can make a difference. That one game can make a huge difference. I mean, you know, there are moments in right. NBA playoff games that turn the tide of an entire series.
But you still right? have to win
so
four.
One game.
You still have to win four.
And I get it. I get it. But when you're talking about a San Antonio team, that when you look at all of the losses, all seven
right.
losses
right.
that Golden State had, San Antonio had three of those.
Yeah.
Of the seven losses that they had all year.
I've already told you the team that I want to see win this year is San Antonio. I've told you that. I want to see San Antonio win this year.
But that's what I'm saying.
If you take
a Spurs team and you walk in there with just one little kink in the armor and the Spurs pick that apart, it's over. You're done.
You're looking at one game. And yes, you can win the series 4-3. It all takes is that one game.
Right.
I don't see this as being a major, block or major, kink in the armor for Golden State to have Steph Curry sit out a game or even sit out this next series. I don't think he will. I think he'll be back for – if they go 3-0, he'll be back for at least game four. He'll be back for half of it. And I think they'll give him some of that game time to get back in. But you do not also want to take the risk of losing him in a series you're going to win anyways, to losing him for the rest of the playoffs. You cannot take that chance.
I totally get that. But look, he can't be the boy in the bubble the entire
postseason. But why, right? Why put that risk out there when it's unnecessary?
Well, and why? I mean,
that's why guys get paid millions of dollars to coach and manage that.
Right. And Steve Kerr is gambling either way. He's gambling by not having Steph Curry come in until the Western Conference Finals.
I'm going to put you with Steve Kerr.
All right. Do it.
You go ahead and you put Steph Curry out there. Steph Curry gets hurt.
Mm-hmm.
What's the reaction to you, Steve Kerr, the coach, that put your star player out there in that predicament for him to get hurt and he's out for the rest of the playoffs?
That's unfortunate, but it could have happened in game one.
I understand that. And if it happens against the Spurs, everybody understands that. But if you're in a series, in a game that you're going to – who are they playing right now? I don't even know who they're playing. Is it Portland?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, Trailblazers.
Portland, they're going to win either 4-4 or 4-1.
Right.
Okay, it's not going to go that further. If you lose Steph Curry against the Portland Trailblazers, do you think your fans are going to let you know about it when you start playing in that championship game against San Antonio? Oh, you're damn right you will.
Absolutely.
You will get ripped apart. You'll get torn apart. The fans will come down on you like a bunch of lead bricks. I mean, it will just be unmerciful.
But if at the same time, if you're that worried about him getting his knee blown up or getting
right now in the playoffs, yes,
game,
I am.
If you're that worried about it in that final game of that series, the very next game, a few days later, there's no difference there.
Well, no, but here's the thing. Yeah,
a freak
okay.
accident
here's,
is a freak accident.
Here's
right?
the thing.
It's not like he got hurt because of fatigue. He slipped on water on the floor.
Okay. Here's the difference. It's like the Cubs playing, let's say, playing Milwaukee. It's the end of the season. You're going in, or let's say it's, going into the end of the season. You're going into the playoffs. you're winning 10-0 in the seventh inning. Arrieta's out there. Arrieta's got a four-hitter going. He's got four hits. You're getting ready to go into the playoffs. Seventh inning, you leave Arrieta out there. Some guy gets up there, Jonathan LaCroix, and by some fluke of nature, lines one right back up the middle, hits Arrieta square in the head, and he is out. Concussion, he is not going to play the rest of the season.
Okay.
Unfortunate, right?
Sure.
Why the hell was Arrieta out there? That is going to be the question, and the thing is all of us Cub fans have waited for 107 years for this championship to come. We're going to look at this, and the first thing we're going to say, oh, there's that damn curse again. But the other thing is you go, why was he in that situation? Why did you not pull him? Why did you not have a – well, he had a four here. I understand.
Well, first of all
– you're winning your division by 20 games. It's 10-0. You're in the seventh inning. He doesn't need to be out there.
First of all, you're talking about coming off of injury or anything like that. You're just talking about a guy doing his normal rotation. So there's
and
that.
And the thing
but at the same time, you get
the idea what I'm getting
to. I get where you're going with it. I get where you're going with it. But at the same time, you see this all across sports. You see this everywhere. You see it in the NFL. You see it in the NHL. Mm-hmm. You see it elsewhere in the NBA.
Well, the NHL, you don't hear about it. It's an upper body injury or lower body injury. Yeah, they keep playing. And when they get done with the series, they go, oh, yeah, by the way, we're sending this guy in for surgery on a broken wrist that he did in the first game seven games ago.
Yeah. Oh, this guy's been playing with a broken spine for 3 months. Yeah.
The guy had a broken leg. He was still out there skating.
Right. But I mean, you've seen this in the NFL. Oh, yeah. You've seen it all over the place. You know, it's not about taking an unnecessary risk. It's risk versus reward. And that's what it is.
In your opinion,
you think that it's not worth the reward of giving him a few game minutes in one of the last couple of games.
I don't mind.
In my opinion, I think it is.
And to me, it's like if you want to put him in that last game, if you're up three, you know.
I mean, I'm not saying make him play 40 minutes.
No. I'm saying
bring him in, have him play 15, 20 minutes.
Well, no, that's what I'm saying. If you're up 3-0, I'd let him play the first quarter. I'd have him come out the first quarter. I'd have him start.
Yeah.
And maybe I bring him back in the third quarter a little bit, just a little bit to get him out there. But the thing is I do not want to sit there and run him out and play him ungodly minutes or get him out there just to get back in the rotation.
Right.
He'll get back in the rotation.
Yeah, you absolutely.
But I don't want to lose him for the rest of the year just because, you know, I wanted to throw him out there because, by God, he should be a tough guy, and he should get out there and he should play.
Don't get me wrong. You can't have a meathead mentality about this and think, oh, well, you know, he should be tough. He should go out there and play. My God, he's played almost 100 games.
Oh, I know.
So far this season. Yeah. You know, it's 82 games, and then you're playing playoffs on top of it.
They've played four games and under 8 games. So, yeah,
right, and then you've got the preseason in front of that. Yeah. So, I mean, he's up over 100 games already with the preseason. Yeah. So, that being the case, you know, he's tough. We get that. But all I'm saying is he's a shooter.
He is.
All right, give him some game minutes. Get him warmed up.
And the thing is watching him shoot, you know, I don't think you're going to lose it.
If it meant nothing, nobody would have shoot-arounds pregame in the NBA. If it meant nothing, nobody would ever have three-on-threes in practice.
But the thing
practices.
Is, as we talk about that, and you told me
if
before.
Shooters were awesome.
But you told me before, the three-on-threes. Three-on-threes aren't good, and the shoot-arounds, blah, 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 but it's not game minutes. And now you're saying, well, they wouldn't have three-on-threes if they weren't shooters. That's what they shoot. And the thing, I don't think he's going to get that far out of practice or that far off of his game by just, you know, doing the practices and doing the three-on-threes right now.
Right. To me, it's not as much about him as it is just the whole team sync. Get the whole team synchronization.
And when you watch a team set a record like they did this year with the wins-loss, I mean, it's, you know, I don't think I'm worried about that team. That team knows how to win, and right now they're knowing how to win without Steph Curry in there on a consistent basis for the last three or four games.
Which is great.
Yes.
Which is great. Don't get me wrong. It's just like I said. I would really like to see him at some point in this series.
And I understand what you're saying. I'm more on the cautious side. You know, I understand. I get it. But I'm more on the cautious side. I can remember a couple years back when the St. Louis Rams in a preseason game, they had their star player running back a punt in like the fourth quarter of a preseason game. They were winning like 28-7.
Right.
Was it the Cardinals or was it maybe Pittsburgh? Blew his knee out. Do you remember what I'm talking about? He was their star player. Blew his knee out on a punt return.
In the fourth quarter, the name escapes me.
I remember the play, you know who I'm talking about.
I can think of it,
they lost him for the year, and he was never the same. Within 2 years, he was out of the league. And this is something in a preseason game, fourth quarter, you're up big. Why is he in there? And I remember that was the question. And I think – I want to say it was the Cardinals because I just remember Mike Martz. That's all I can think of him saying, well, you know what? He's a football player, and he's out there playing football.
Right.
And that was his comment, and you're going, okay. You just took your franchise player, your best player, and lost him for the year on a punt return you didn't need to have him out there for.
Right.
And that's where I'm going with this whole Steph Curry thing. As valuable as he is, I wouldn't want to, if I was a Golden State fan, if I'm in the Golden State management brass and everything else, I don't want to lose my star player in a series I know I'm going to win. And you can't say, well, you don't know you're going to win. Yes, you're going to win that series. There's no way in hell Portland's going to beat them. You know, none. Unless all of the Golden State Warriors come down with some massive flu or some massive virus and they can't play. That's the only way Portland's going to beat them. And I just I wouldn't want to see that. I wouldn't want to take that chance. You know, just because of the idea of what you could do, but also the fallout that you're going to see from your fans and your support base.
Right. All right, we gotta
move. I know. We gotta move forward. Cavaliers.
Well, we gotta get to the Cavaliers, so we gotta move forward on this. But I mean, yeah, I think we're two sides of the same coin on this. We both want to be cautious, but we both want to see him. Anyhow, the Cavaliers, man. You want to talk about putting the smackdown on the Hawks. It was not only in Game 2 of the Eastern Conference Semifinals Wednesday night, not only did they beat up on the Atlanta Hawks, who really honestly aren't as good as seed is. No, I mean, this is kind of the Eastern Conference has been like this the last few years.
Eastern Conference, like the little sisters of the poor.
It is.
You got Cleveland and nobody else.
At the top. Might be able to almost make a case for Boston or maybe even possibly make a case for Indiana.
No.
Maybe. But once you get past Cleveland, the drop-off is so harsh.
Oh, it is.
And you get to Atlanta. Atlanta had an excellent record by beating up on awful teams. And the Cavaliers showed them.
Can we play Charlotte
again?
Could we play them one more time?
And they
How about New Orleans? How about the Pelicans? Can we play the Pelicans?
And they showed how bad they could beat up on somebody the other night. And en route to the 123-98 victory.
Ouch. How do you have that big of win when you get to the playoffs?
That's a big win margin in the playoffs. It is. They broke the NBA record for three-pointers made in a game, regular or postseason. They hit 25 three-point shots.
Unbelievable.
25.
They just sat out there and just
check this out.
You know.
Just in the first half, 18 three-pointers.
How many did they miss?
You know what?
They took 25 out of 70 shots or something because Atlanta was that horrible. They could just sit out there and keep shooting, get their own rebounds, and go back out there and shoot again.
And what's really funny is this caught a lot of heat. There were a lot of people not happy about this because the Cavs were up. Because they were up. They were still shooting threes late in the game to get
the
record.
You know what? Stop them.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I thought the same thing. I really did. I was like,
there's one thing to go out and embarrass somebody.
Right.
You know, and in football, throwing the Hail Mary pass when you're up 68-3. Yeah, I can understand being a little pissed off about that.
Right.
But in basketball, a three-point shot is just – right now, that's just a normal shot now.
Yeah, it's part of the game.
That's not a long-distance shot anymore. I remember when they first put the three-point shot. Oh, my God, they got that three-point shot. You got to shoot from way downtown.
Yeah, and then they backed it up.
Yeah.
Then they backed it up another foot.
And the thing is that, now they've been shooting it so long, your seven-foot players, can shoot the three-pointer.
Yeah, and you've got, most of your guards and most of your forwards are decent three-point guys.
That's all they shoot.
They're usually shooting from a foot behind the three-point line anyway.
Look at Steph Curry. So, he'll shoot from 5 feet beyond.
Oh, yeah, he'll shoot from the half court.
But, I mean, it's not that big a deal anymore, really.
Well, apparently, there was a little exception made. I didn't know if you caught this at all.
No.
But there was a little exception made by Mr. Sir Charles TNT's coverage of Charles Barkley took exception to this and actually called out the Cavaliers for for, you know, shooting all these three pointers and
Didn't he say something that was very objectionable? Because I read a little bit about that they were talking about maybe they should get rid of Charles for what he said.
I did not read the transcripts. I read a few reactions from it, but all I heard, Steve, all I know is that it was terrible. It was terrible.
These guys were terrible.
I think he made reference. I think he made a very, very poor reference to something, and there were calls for his ouster.
You know what was really funny, though? The one person that took incredible exception to what Charles said was another Charles Oakley.
Oh, God.
Yeah. Otherwise known in us old school NBA fans, a man who you did not want to on defense at all
If you went down the lane, you ended up without a head.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He was taking your head clean off. Oh, yeah.
And I just thought the amazing irony, the amazing irony of this. And remember, he's from Cleveland. He's a Cleveland guy. He's a big Cavs fan.
Yeah.
The amazing irony of this is if any team would have done that to a team that Oakley was on, he would have been out there on the three-point line waiting for him to set the shot.
As soon as he
would have shoved him into about the third row.
No, he would have come down with a hammer. It's like Dennis Rodman saying you're too brash.
Right.
You know, it just doesn't happen. No.
Yeah.
Oakley calling it out, it's like, wow, really? Is Lambeer getting upset now too?
Oh, I thought that was wonderful. And then on top of it, he defended his remarks against Charles Barkley, and he also, at the same time, said the same thing I pretty much did. Look, the Hawks aren't that good.
They aren't.
They just aren't that good.
No.
And, you know, this is not a big deal. You see teams all the time shooting three-pointers towards the end of games. You know, they don't care. You know, there's nothing.
No, and half,
they know
and half
you're not coming back into it. So if they hit 30% of them, they're still going
to
clean
and
your
the
clock.
Thing is half the fans want them to shoot the threes because on the back of their ticket it says, if they score 100 points, you get a free Big Mac or something.
Yeah, right.
Hey, exactly. Big Mac. You know, I've been at games.
I've
been at games where you have those. And by the time you get to 90, the fans are screaming. There's only like 3 minutes left. Yeah. Come on. And you're going, I don't even like the damn Big Mac.
You can
have mine if they win it.
Yeah, they're like their bookies in the corner and they're waiting for their team to cover. It's like, come on, you can score three more. Come on, Daddy needs a new pair of shoes.
Daddy needs a Big Mac. Ray Kroc's going, okay, stop him. Stop him. Just throw the hamburger out there. Get the hamburger out there.
Hamburger.
I can't afford it. I can't afford this anymore.
Oh, that's wonderful. You know. But look. I thought it was hilarious though that the irony was the greatest though about Oakley
and Oakley is unbelievable.
And they've never really liked each other.
They played against each other a few times.
There was that the one particular case. I'm trying to think. I can't remember the game. But I remember there was one particular case, the two of them came down for a rebound. Next thing you know, they're coming up swinging.
With both of them, that wouldn't surprise me at all. I mean, you talk about some feisty players.
I think Barkley was still playing with the 76ers at the time.
And Oakley had to be with the Knicks.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Didn't Oakley start with the Bulls?
Yeah. Very.
He played, I think, what, first two seasons,
maybe
two
or three, very and then short went
to. And then they traded him to the Knicks. Isn't that how they got Cartwright?
Yeah.
I think that's how they got Cartwright.
Yeah. So it definitely would have been. And it would make
better Bill Cartwright. I'm going to talk like this.
Man, that dude had one of
the deepest.
Have you ever? Do you remember him at the free throw line, though?
Oh, yeah. Oh, my God.
Well, I mean, I don't. No, I mean, but like his set for the free, he would like grab the ball, and he'd do this weird roundabout thing,
and then he'd shoot it right over his head like this.
Yeah, and he'd throw it like he'd have it way up over his head. Yeah. So by now the ball's like 9.5 feet in the air, almost equal to the rim, and it's like, well, that's why centers
can't shoot free throws
because the damn ball is already up over the rim.
It's like, can I just dunk it from here?
Yeah, right. If I can do it in one step and then step back, can I just dunk the ball? No, he had one of the craziest shots.
Yes, he did.
It was hilarious. I actually, as a kid, I tried to do it a couple of times.
You tried to do it like that? Oh.
Yeah, I immediately decided that was a bad idea.
Now, I tried to do the Rick Barry for a while there.
What's
the underhand? The underhand.
Oh, that's remember Rick Barry did the underhand. Yeah, he had that granny shot looking thing.
And boy, what he shoot? 98% free throws, something like that.
Yeah. Well, I'm not saying it was a bad shot. It was just ugly.
But it swished every time, man.
Worse than Charles Barkley's golf swing.
I don't know.
I know there's very little in the
Charles
world.
Charles Barkley or Michael Jordan's golf swing?
Jordan actually doesn't have a horrible golf swing.
No, he actually got better when he first started, though.
Yeah.
I mean, how much money did Jordan lose on the golf course?
Yeah, hey, I'll bet you he still can't hit a curveball.
I bet he still can't either. But by God, he's going to play for the Sox and he's going to play in the major leagues.
Why not? Oh, boy, I'm going to tell you what. You want to talk about a bad decision. Worst sports decision ever.
I'm going to take I'm going to take a couple years away from the game to go play baseball. Huh?
Yeah.
You guys just won three championships in a row. You were the MVP for three straight years.
Oh, by the way, you could have had the ultimate basketball dynasty. I'm still blaming.
Well, if you put it this way, I mean,
he would have stayed.
They would have won eight in a row.
They would have won eight in a row.
Yeah.
Eight in a row.
And that would have been right next to the Celtics for their long run.
What was the Celtics run?
Wasn't the Celtics like 11 or 12? Yeah, something like that. But you look at those were the teams before free agency, though.
Right.
I mean, that's when you had Bill Russell, Bob Cousy, and all those guys all the time.
Yeah, it was that one team, and that was it. And not only that, but you had fewer teams and much less talent.
Right.
So, you know, I mean,
you know, when Will Chamberlain can score 100 points in a game.
Yeah,
and not win the championship.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah. That gives you an idea.
Yeah, it gives you an idea. So yeah, I just thought that was a great story. I figured you would enjoy that.
I could just see Barkley and Oakley going at it again.
Oh man,
we saw the Barkley.
That whole thing's on. I wish I could pull it through because that whole thing's on ESPN.
You know, after you showed me the Barkley Shaquille O'Neal fight, I'd like to see Oakley and Barkley go at it now. And Shaquille O'Neal be the special guest referee.
I honestly
WrestleMania right there. Come on, Vince McMahon, bring it up.
Yeah, I honestly think that by the end of his career, Charles Barkley is going to threaten to fight or attempt to fight everybody.
Why not?
Everybody. I mean, seriously.
Eyes are just terrible.
Yeah, at some point in the minute, Conor McGregor, you really aren't that tough. I could take you with one cheeseburger in one hand. And really, if you look, his ground game is just horrible. It really is.
Can you see the little car they're driving to the NCAA playoff with Samuel L. Jackson, Spike Lee? Charles Barkley's there beating on him. Take that, Samuel! Take that! Spike! That one! Warn me out of you!
And you know, Samuel L. Jackson would be driving. He'd get tired of you. Why don't you guys keep it down back there? I am getting tired of all these gosh darn hits on these gosh darn people in my car.
Oh, man.
Oh, I had to clean that up a little bit because I know Sam Jackson would have dropped a few choice words.
No, he would have. I think we digressed a little bit there.
Yes, we totally
have. We better get back on track, I think.
I think we lost this show.
It's
over.
That's okay. We still got an hour to bring it back, maybe.
Oh, bring it back?
Maybe.
No, wheels are off. We've literally talked about Conor McGregor and Charles Barkley getting in a fight. I think
I'd pay for it. I never even watched one of those things. I'd watch that one.
It would be a fantastic pay-per-view.
I think it would be.
If speaking of which, somebody was doing this the other day.
Okay.
And I had heard this. I thought it was a fantastic idea, and it actually got spurred from I don't want to call it fake. It was kind of like a fantasy fight between Conor McGregor and Floyd Mayweather. Boxing. Not Ooh. MMA rules, but boxing rules. Personally, I don't care what you think about Floyd Mayweather. Conor McGregor, if he had to straight box gloves, all that, he'd get killed. Yeah, he'd get his clock clean.
He'd get killed.
Totally. I mean, you've got professional fighters been fighting for 20, 25 years that can't hit Floyd Mayweather.
Yeah.
You know, McGregor wouldn't be able to do it.
But the other thing is Floyd Mayweather can't hit either. He just throws up his little patsy hands.
But still, regardless.
He'd win.
Regardless, it's a fake fight. It's never going to happen.
No.
But it brought up an interesting conversation that I heard at some point this week, and I wanted to bring it up to you.
Okay.
We always talk about these, and everybody thinks it's ridiculous, obviously. Anybody that knows anything about sports thinks it's ridiculous. But we always talk about these fantasy matchups, like, is this team so bad that, the Philadelphia 76ers this year, right? Yeah. So bad that, they could get beat by Kentucky.
No.
In a game on a neutral field or something like that. Or, the Jacksonville Jaguars are so bad that, the Ohio State Buckeyes or Alabama could beat them or something like that. Obviously, the answer is no.
Right.
The talent level is so different.
And you could say, hey, maybe out of 10 games, maybe they win one.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know.
And the thing is they'd have to put everything together. One game. And anything can happen in one game because they're all good athletes. But the difference in talent, the difference in levels of talent, these teams like, you go to Ohio State, you go to Alabama and these teams there, you have, six or seven good ball players.
Right.
You go to Jacksonville, and I'm sorry, those six or seven ball players are just part of 22 players on that team.
Right.
And that's the biggest difference. So, those things you talk about, you may think they're rotten, you may think they're horrible, but you go up against the best college team, the college team still gets their butts wiped.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. But it brought up an interesting question, favorite fantasy matchup. I want you to think about that for a second. We got to hit a commercial break anyway. I want you to think about it for a minute. When we come back, I want you to give me your best fantasy matchup.
I give you a football. I can give you a football right now.
Well, think about it. Just sit on it for a minute. Okay. Sit on it for a minute, and we'll come back. We got to do this. We're overdue anyway. So when we come back, we're going to talk favorite fantasy matchup.
Are we going to go by sport?
We can do that. Yeah, we can do that. Think of a few of them. Okay. We'll do that. So, all right. Cool. Well, we're going to do that, and we will be right back after this. You're listening to the Cheap Seats. 1 hour down, 1 hour to go here on XERS Radio.
Life is meant to be savored. If you find the reason, Morgan's and the Little Black Dog Tavern in downtown Mishawaka, Indiana, will make it special. From the casual European atmosphere to the high-end tavern fare, Morgan's and the Little Black Dog Tavern give you the chance to savor every day. Stop in and savor your day with your choice of a wide variety of drinks, from a classic martini to the best beers from local breweries. Savor your day on the patio, or come in and enjoy a glass of wine with some of our mouth-watering entrees. We're located in the historic Cam Brewery Stable Building in the 100 Center in downtown Mishawaka, Indiana. Call 574-807-0101 for reservations. Like us on Facebook to find out today's food and drink specials, or stop by our website at morgansandlbd.com. Drink in the moments, feast on the memories, savor every day at Morgan's and the Little Black Dog Tavern.
Where do you go when you're looking for great food, a cold drink, and some of the best local live music? I go to the Phoenix, located on the corner of Lincoln Way and Main Street in historic downtown Mishawaka. Thursday nights, it's open jam with $2 well drinks. Friday and Saturdays, there's always live music with no cover charge. Great food, cheap drinks, excellent service. The place to be is the Phoenix.
Have you heard those two wacky guys, Chris and Ginn, on the Life is Art Also show? They share their favorite songs and their future favorites, too. They have live interviews with authors, comedians, artists and musicians, and lots more. They also have a Word of the Week with Mad Dog Ho, the official lexicographer of Internet Radio. Tune in every Thursday, 6 p.m. on XERS.com.
It's Maximus and the Bartender.
Now, all of a sudden, after LeBron goes home, they couldn't wait, Big Daddy. Now, Kevin Durant going back to Washington, D.C.?
Wait a minute. Durant to D.C.? I don't see that happening. Ever. Ever.
Marion Barry got reelected, remember?
Kevin Durant is not going to D.C. He's not being traded. He's not going to force a trade.
Remember,
he's happy in Oklahoma City with Westbrook.
It's D.C. where the cost of living is going up and the chance of living is going down.
Tune in every Tuesday night, 6 p.m. Eastern at xersradio.com.
You're
Radio, Northern Indiana's number one rated internet radio station.
Love that bass drop. That's yeah. I waited a long time for it, but it's
yeah,
so
I know. I went out and had a cigarette or two yeah, before right. I came back in for that one.
Smoke a pack waiting for that one.
Yeah.
The Cheap Seats on XCRS Radio. We are back. 1 hour to go. Actually, a little less than an hour, but whatever.
It's okay. Bill said we'd go late.
There we go. All right.
We got an hour to go.
Hour to go. All right. Well, hey, before we went to break, we were talking greatest fantasy matchups. This obviously coming from the Conor McGregor Floyd Mayweather fantasy matchup. So I want to hear some of yours. What do you got?
John Holmes. Oh no, not that kind of fantasy. Okay.
Why are you having a fantasy about John Holmes? Wait. Hold on.
I want to whip this thing.
We just came. Hold on. Yes. Crashing stop.
Well, you were talking fantasy. I was going to bring up some of the women first. But
you have just created.
I want to move on to something else. Okay, fantasy.
You have just, wait.
Yeah, you stop. Have just created, stop.
You Get have serious. Just created the soundbite of the year.
Well, I wanted to be able to do something tonight. I mean, this show's been a total train wreck. I might as well go ahead and just totally destroy it.
We're going to be at the company party in December, and I'm going to be like, soundbite of the year
there
goes
you go.
To.
That's right. I want to be able to stand up and collect my Willis.
Yes.
The Willis Award.
The Willie Award.
The Willie Award. That's right. The Wet Willie Award.
Well, only on Tuesdays. All right, let's go.
Yes, or if the pool's nearby. I would love to see, if we went to football, Notre Dame versus Green Bay.
Wow, really?
Well, you talk about the team that has, I mean, in college.
I was
kind of
hoping you'd have like a, I was kind of more thinking like, you know, maybe like the teams that, you know, like you put the two teams together and one might have a shot.
Oh, no. And the thing is that.
You really
I mean,
think Notre Dame would have some kind of outside chance against Green Bay?
I think it'd be a decent game. No, I don't think it'd be. If you want to go that way, I mean,
yeah,
I was just going. Yeah. I was just thinking about matchups. I'd love to see.
Well, that's
just matchups. I'd love
I think
to see
it
that. That'd be great.
It wouldn't be a game. I mean,
no.
By halftime, you're talking like 40 to nothing by halftime.
Well, yeah. Rodgers would just
wipe
on. If you're talking about someone that would have a chance, I would put in football. I'd love to see Alabama Jacksonville. I'd love to see Alabama New Orleans. That'd be a fun one.
I'd probably like to see
or LSU New Orleans. If the thing I'd like in these fantasies, things that are more like regional, like you have Green Bay, Notre Dame. You've got that there. They've got that.
I would actually like to see Ohio State versus the Cleveland Browns in state.
Yeah, I mean, that'd be awesome. And the thing is, as many people that love, well, even Ohio State versus Cincinnati.
Yeah, but Cincinnati, I think, would have a much better chance at cleaning the
clock. Oh, I do too.
And I'm not saying the Browns. Yeah. I'm not saying the Browns wouldn't beat them either, but it. I think if you're talking about a team that had any kind of an outside chance, that would be it. Alabama, I could pretty much say Alabama would be a better shot at winning. But Alabama and Cleveland,
how about
they
Alabama,
really have
Tampa
nothing
Bay?
To each other. That I could go for that.
Or
Tampa
or,
Bay,
or
Jacksonville,
or even Ohio State, Atlanta.
No, Atlanta's offense would crush Atlanta's had
a tough time with their offense, except for Julio Jones.
Matt Ryan would destroy. He'd pick apart any. He'd do an Aaron Rodgers to anybody.
His line still sucks.
It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter.
Some of those guys would be getting in.
Come on, man.
There
is no college front seven that is going to get through that offensive line.
Let me think. You know, even if you just go to college, some games you'd love to see.
Well, yeah, but those are possible that those could actually happen. So I don't really I'm more talking about, you know, something that's never going to happen ever, not in a million years ever. Period. Right. You know, like put Venus Williams versus like one of the top male tennis players in the country. You know, like put her up against like Novak Djokovic or somebody like that. I would love to see that. You know, or I think another good one for me would be probably to take, say the Kentucky basketball team and put them up against, I don't know, like the Dallas Mavericks, or put them up against maybe against 76ers or something like that. Or take like UConn, take the UConn national championship team, put them up against like the Comets
something. What I would love to see is take the UConn women's team, put up against any of the WNBA teams.
And I'll tell you right now, though, as far as sports go, I think that is where you could find your
matchups.
Possible, if they played a series of 10, you're talking maybe even the college team could win 2 or 3. And the reason why I say that is if you look at those teams, like we'll take Kentucky or we'll take UConn, the last 2 years of UConn. I mean, picks 1, 2, 3 all came out of that school.
Right. Oh, yeah.
You know? Yeah. So, I mean, the best, if your number 1, 2, and 3 pick in the draft are coming off of that team's probably good enough to play against you. So, you know, I mean, when you look at that level of talent, you know, you have that there. But when you do look at, you know, crossing over into another sport, such as like this Conor McGregor, this supposed made up fight or whatever,
right?
I think if you were to tweak the rules, it would actually be an interesting fight.
If you allowed grappling, I think McGregor would beat him. Don't allow a ground game.
Don't allow a ground game. Allow kicks.
Gloves. I'd say allow throws.
Yeah, there you go.
Allow throws.
No ground game.
Allow elbows. Allow arms. Kicks.
Yep. And take the gloves off. Yep.
But the only thing I think you give Conor McGregor a shot. Well, I think you do.
Outside shot, because you still got to catch him to hit him.
Well, the thing, you got to catch him, but the other thing is that, you know, Mayweather is such a good spar. I mean, he can spar really well. He can jab and jab. And I think he'd be able to jab enough to keep McGregor away. Though I think McGregor, you know, once you start jabbing, what he's going to do, he's going to rush you.
Yeah.
He might get
one or two jabs in the face, but he's going to have his face buried in your chest.
Well, the thing is, you're going to have to get two or three jabs quickly in, and then you got to move.
Right.
And then jab again, then move, jab again, move until you can put some damage on him.
Right.
You know, the problem is McGregor with his face, I mean, he's taken enough beatings already. It doesn't really make a difference. A couple jabs aren't going to kill him.
Yeah. No, yeah. He's definitely, his face model career is done. I mean, he's not exactly as bad as Nate Diaz.
I think all those guys, the face model job is over with. Yeah. But,
not as bad as Nate Diaz. Have you ever seen him in a press conference?
I've seen some of those guys where their nose is over here.
What's really funny is Nate Diaz in a pre-fight press conference does not look any different than what he does in a post-fight press conference.
Maybe his nose is on the other side of his face. He's a little sweatier,
but aside from that.
What's your nose with that hump?
I mean, seriously.
It's like young Frankenstein. What the hump? What hump?
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly.
What happened to your nose? What nose?
Yeah. No, exactly. I mean, you look at Nate Diaz sits down for a conference. And he just sits down, looks at the crowd. Everybody's looking back, and I'm like, You just get in a car wreck, bro?
What the hell happened to you?
Somebody just hit you on the way in here, man? What's up with this?
Someone beat you with the ugly stick. Really gotcha.
Beat him with the stick? Dude, he fell out of the ugly tree and hit every branch on the way down. Oh, my God.
But, I mean,
God.
You know, if you start taking a look at like, your fantasy matchups, you know, I would, you know, I'd be more enthralled to just see, like I say, Green Bay versus Notre Dame. Ohio State versus Cleveland. More of those regional matchups, you know, say a Penn State versus the Giants. You know, different regional matchups where you've got, you know, that tie-in. Because the problem is that I don't think you can take a college team, even a good college team, and put them against a pro team and expect the college team to beat the pro team.
I don't think it's going to happen.
You know, and I even think if you take the best one and put it against the worst, you're not going to have that. But just to have that regional flair,
right?
I think that would be, you know, it'd be like the Wisconsin Badgers taking on Green Bay.
There's got to be
that'd be cool. Northwestern versus Chicago.
There has to be some billionaire out here who wants to make this happen.
Mark Cuban.
Seriously. Yeah, Jerry Jones. You know, he's got a nice big stadium he likes to donate out.
Yeah.
Come on, man. This is perfect. This is a great idea. I mean, you know, you put this on a pay-per-view, DirecTV selling a million of them.
You know, it's like...
Guarantee it.
Yeah, you know, Vince McMahon, we're going to have the XFL. We'll call this the ZFL. That's right. Yeah, we'll bring something else out.
Dude, Vince McMahon, I mean, he's... choking for ideas.
Oh, he is.
I haven't watched wrestling forever.
Oh, God. I was watching a couple years ago.
I hear it's
I had to actually stop because, you know, when your whole basis is predicated on your storyline,
yeah,
and you can't write a storyline anymore.
Right.
I mean, that's when you got to get new writers.
Man. To me, it's like a... You know, like watching soap operas over the last 25, 30 years.
Well, no,
you've recycled how many stories?
Well, the problem is right now they don't have any stories. They don't have any fresh stories. I mean, because they're using
There's no such thing as a fresh story. When you do something,
but the thing is, you know, for so many years. Well,
put it
this way, but even with sitcoms, you know, sitcoms have their same, I mean, they all follow the same thing, but, you know, different writers are able to find something different to make it different. The problem is with wrestling is you have the same story writers that were there 25 years ago when it was hot to right now, they don't know what to do anymore because they've already done it. They can't refreshen it. They've got to get new people in there. I mean, I can remember, was it 5-6 years ago where when you looked at the ratings on off of network TV, you just went to cable,
right,
wrestling
sure.
held, what, 7 of the top 10 spots?
Wow, really?
Oh, yeah. They were hot. Every night they had, they were 1 through 5 for a while.
That's crazy.
And the problem is that all of a sudden it got old.
See, I'm not a wrestling guy, so I mean, this is kind of alien.
Yeah,
to me,
see, I watched it a lot when the kids were little and loved it.
Well,
yeah,
see, I loved the whole
NWO and all that stuff.
I watched it when I was a kid.
Yeah,
and I did too. So I get it.
We watched it Sunday morning.
Yeah,
know?
I mean, I watched it back when it was, you know, Hulk Hogan and Andre the Giant and all that.
Yeah,
stuff.
I watched it even before that. So.
Well, you know, I'm probably too young to remember most
of
that.
When you had Vern Gagne, Nick Bockwinkel, the Crusher.
Now, see, I remember the names, but I don't think I've ever seen.
And then it went for a little bit. Then Hulk Hogan brought it back.
Yeah,
and then it went a little bit. Then they brought the whole WCW, WWE, WWF at that time, and had the NWO, and Hogan jumped from one show to the other, and
right.
and they had the big feud, and that went huge again. And then WWF, they decided, well, you know, the best thing you do to your competitors, buy them, so they bought them out.
Wow.
You know, and then from then on, I mean, they had some good years, and now they just don't have the story anymore. And how the hell did we get to wrestling?
I don't know.
How did we get to wrestling?
I don't know. This is, I mean, really, this is like been, I think this is like ADD day for us.
You know, we have touched on so many different subjects that we've never talked about.
No, this is weird.
Do you want to talk about scuba diving now? I mean, you
know. Why not? Surfing. Hey, how about that?
Hey, water polo.
Shout out to my peeps out in the
water polo. Come on. I'm going to be treading some water out here.
I'll tell you, we'll start getting listed. Hey, we talk about surfing and scuba diving and stuff. We're going to pick up the California people.
Boy, I tell you, the ratings going to shoot through the roof.
My boys out in L.A. be listening. I guarantee it.
You know, we do have to talk a little bit here. We get past the break. We're going to have to talk about Kentucky Derby a little bit.
It is coming up.
And we've
coming up.
Saturday. That's tomorrow. That is correct. I'd say it's coming up a little bit. It's tomorrow.
Yeah.
And the favorite actually has the name of a very popular Red Wings player.
Who's that?
Nyquist.
Nyquist.
Nyquist is the favorite.
Huh. No kidding.
No kidding.
Now, refresh my memory, because yes, you are the horse racing guy.
I try.
Refresh my memory on the Kentucky Derby, Triple Crown
the
last
Triple
year.
Crown,
what
yeah.
happened?
American Pharoah was the first Triple Crown winner in, since Secretariat back in, 72.
Yeah, so we did have a Triple Crown winner last year.
Yes, we did. Yes, we did.
And so what are they saying? What's the early
talk about? Well, right now, Nyquist is a favorite. Now, the thing is Nyquist is coming out of the 13th hole, which, for him has been very good so far. I mean, he's run out of there before in other races and done well. He's won. I believe Nyquist has not lost yet.
Really?
So he's coming in very well. He is the prohibitive favorite going in. There are a couple other things. But, that's the whole thing. Once they get to these big races, and yes, they've done, the different derbies and they've done so forth leading up to this, the little stakes and so forth. Once you get to the derby, as crazy as the Kentucky Derby is, as pomp and circumstance and all this, it's very easy for all of a sudden a horse you never heard of to come out of nowhere and take it.
Right.
Last year I think was the first year in a long time where the favorite was American Pharoah coming in. And American Pharoah just did not disappoint. Went on to the did not disappoint Belmont again and, won the Triple Crown.
Right.
Before that, I mean, your favorite, I don't think we've had the prohibitive favorite win the Kentucky Derby, out of the last 10 years, maybe four or five times. You've always had someone come out of the pack that, wow, this one came out of nowhere and did it. So it's going to be interesting. I think the weather's supposed to be nice. I want to say it's supposed to be 70 down in Louisville for this week, 70 and sunny. So it should be interesting. I'm looking forward to it. I watch a total of maybe three horse races a year. The Kentucky Derby, the Preakness, and
the Belmont
Stakes. Yep,
gotcha.
That's it. I can remember even in college.
Right.
Here I am out at the fraternity house. We're drinking crazy, and on Saturday the Kentucky Derby comes. Everybody stops, goes down, watches the Kentucky Derby,
talks about it, and then goes back out.
Yeah.
Right.
But I mean, it's one of those. And there are only a few. Firmed one in 78. That was the last one.
Ah, there we go.
But, I mean, the thing is that there are only a few events that, are one type of events that people stop and will watch whether they're interested in the sports or not. The Kentucky Derby is one. Another one, the Indianapolis 500.
Right.
Whether you are a race fan or not, people stop and watch that.
Daytona
500 is another one. Super Bowl.
Yep.
Whether you are a football fan or not, you will stop and watch the Super Bowl. People will party and watch the Super Bowl.
Some people will watch it just for the commercials.
Yeah. And those are the things that transcend sports. Those are events. The Kentucky Derby is an event. It's more of an event than the Preakness or the Belmont Stakes unless the horses won the first two.
Right.
Then that Belmont becomes so much more important. But, the events that can stand on their own, the Kentucky Derby, Indianapolis 500, Daytona, and in my opinion, Super Bowl. Those are the four that I don't care what happens. People will watch them whether they like that sport or not.
I'm trying to think if there's any other sports.
The only thing I'm thinking is maybe World Cup, but I mean that's lately.
Once America became kind of a viable
right. It's like watching the Olympics. You watch it every 4 years.
Right.
These are things that happen every year.
Would you say the Masters? Maybe. I'm sitting there thinking it, but then at the same time, I'm saying nobody's really going to dedicate 4 days to that.
I think that's the problem is it's 4 days.
Right.
These other ones, they're one-day events.
Even the final round, unless there's some massive storyline that everybody's
Tiger Woods, or Jordan Spieth when he was running away with it last year.
Right.
Those type of things,
the casual, but there's still going to be some sort of a golf fan.
Yeah.
You're not going to get somebody that doesn't care about anything.
No, but I think those four events, I think they transcend the sport itself because they are that they're that big.
I'll tell you right now, one for sure, the whole world will be watching, regardless if you care about baseball or not, Game 7 of the World Series if the Chicago Cubs are involved.
I think the World Series in general if the Cubs are involved.
Yeah, I agree. We got to hit a break. When we come right back, who knows what we're going to talk about on this ADD-ridden...
It's potpourri night.
It certainly is. This ADD-ridden Mother's Day version of the
We can't even spit that out. Seeds. Come on, spit it out.
Who knows? Who knows?
Let's just go to break.
All I know, we got to pay bills. We'll there be back in a minute.
Hey, it's Maximus.
And the bartender.
Tune in every Tuesday night, 6 p.m. Eastern at xersradio.com for Maximus and the Bartender.
And make sure you check out all the great shows. Find out the lineup for Extras Radio on extrasradio.com.
Contact Kickstart Studios, audio recording services for all your recording needs. Songwriters, comedians, band demos, commercials, voiceovers, narration, sound effects, background music. Give us a call, 574-274-8046. Kickstart Studios at Comcast.net or like us on Facebook at Kickstart Studios.
From all of the games on our big screens to the best collection of memorabilia from your favorite sports greats, Rock Sports Bar and Grill in downtown Mishawaka has you covered. Our menu features something for everyone. Amazing sandwiches and wraps, and the best burgers around, including the Rockstar Overdose. 2 half-pound patties served with bacon, cheddar cheese, and piled high with French fries. Like us on Facebook to check out our daily food and drink specials that are sure to be great on your gut and easy on your wallet. We've got you covered between game days, too. Wednesday night is trivia night, where you can match wits with your buddies for great prizes. And every weekend, Rocks features great music from some of Michiana's finest artists. Come see why there's no better place to get your fan fix than Rocks Sports Bar and Grill in the Yorktown Center building in downtown Mishawaka. For those who come to Rocks, we salute you.
Broadcasting to the four corners of the earth, Michiana Edge, every Sunday night, 7 p.m., xersradio.com.
You stick with it and you're passionate about it, you'll get better.
Climb aboard Starship Comedy and join co-hosts Adam Nielsen and
your beloved comedian, Colton Colt.
As we boldly go where no internet radio team from Michiana has gone before.
I am a legend from the future.
We will travel to the comedy underworld so you will know where's the show.
I miss when drinking was fun, man. You know what I mean? Like, before it was like a problem.
If it's funny or it's cool, we will cover it. Hey. See what I did there?
I was sent from space.
Dude, that's gold.
Just like my jokes.
Your mama must be so proud.
Why can't you love me?
Hey, this is Maximus and the Bartender. Make sure you're checking out our brand new show bringing sports talk to you right here live on Extras Radio.
Tune in every Tuesday night, 6 p.m. for all the latest sports news. NFL, baseball, basketball, hockey, you name it, we got it.
And make sure you check Extras Radio out on Facebook as well.
You can get there through xersradio.com.
XERS Radio, check it with you. Laptop, car, or on the phone. Extras Radio on the net.
Hi, my name's Dan Allen, and I like XERS Radio.
And we are back. Cheap Seats on XERS Radio. Follow us on Facebook. Get on there. Go
That's
to Facebook.
Right.
I know you're on Facebook because you're
am.
On the internet listening to this show.
That's right.
So go on Facebook, search The Cheap Seats with Steve. Like the page. Get all the updates. You can get a podcast of the show. You can download it right
there. Or if
your
you want, look on Facebook for The cool Cheap stuff. Seats with Steve. Which Steve is it?
It just says The Cheap Seats with Steve.
I know.
I didn't want to force everybody to spell it all out. I tried to abbreviate it, but then it looked stupid.
I know.
It looked like one of those weird government abbreviations.
If you want to join the cheap seats. If you want to join the cheap seats with Willis, it's cheap seats with Steve. If you want to join the cheap seats with me, Detterman, it's cheap seats with Steve. So just go ahead and take a pick.
Yeah, yeah. Choose your favorite Willis, or choose your favorite Steve.
I really think the medication is starting to wear off.
Yeah, no, definitely not. You can also check us out on Twitter. My Twitter handle is at TCS Willis, Mr. Detterman.
It's at SP Detterman.
There you go. And
I might check it this year.
And remember, we are part of the iHeartRadio family, Clear Channel Media.
Yes, we are.
Sponsors iHeartRadio, and we are on iHeartRadio. So if you miss the show, just go to iHeartRadio and look up the cheap seats.
We are
under the Talk Podcast. Obviously, it is not the famous song by one, I believe it's Alabama. That comes up if you pull up.
Yes, I like the cheap. If you
type in the cheap seats, that's the first thing that comes up.
That's our theme song.
No, it's not.
Okay, it's not our theme song.
No, it's not.
I went and saw them last year. You know.
Is it? Did you?
Yes, I did.
You like country?
I like Alabama. Okay. There are some country. I like some of the more country rockers. I like Garth.
That's like asking somebody if they like metal, and they say, "Well, I like Five Finger Death Punch." It's like, okay, you don't like metal.
Yeah, I like Metallica, you know, something like that. You know, okay, I went and watched Megadeth. I went and watched Slayer.
You know, see, I couldn't see you as a.
I went with my son. We went and watched.
Really?
Yeah, we went.
Did you like curl up in a ball and cry when they started playing Raining Blood?
We went up to Detroit to Joe Louis, and we saw. I think it was Testament, Megadeth, and Slayer, and Megadeth stole the show. They were tremendous.
I'll buy that. I've always liked Dave Mustaine.
They were tremendous. And Slayer came out and played. And you know, my sense of, well, you know, the guy had just, he'd hurt his neck and everything else. So, you know, it is affecting them because they couldn't bang their heads around enough or something. I'm going, whatever. You know, but no, I've been to a couple different shows. That's the kind of music my son likes, kind of he plays. In fact, he has his first show tonight.
That's awesome. Right,
down in Cincinnati, their group down there.
What kind of music does he play?
You just heard it. The metal. I mean, it's
metal.
It's the metal.
So what you're saying is first show at maybe like an old folks home, retirement home, or something.
Yeah,
like that.
that's right. They pull out their instruments. Yeah. You know, they pull out the trombone.
Bingo.
Well, we're playing metal tonight. We're playing metal. We brought out the trombone and the cornet.
Could you see the old man in the crowd? I've got some metal. I've got a titanium hip.
Just a minute, where's the detector at? I can find a lot of it out here for you. I just go to this guy's mouth.
Hold on, so this is the kind of stuff that you were listening to.
Yeah.
This is Raining Blood by Slayer.
Yeah.
And this Slayer! Is
and everybody's gotta yell that out.
Yeah, I do.
Which
seriously.
I you know.
This is one of those songs that you hear it and you just kind of, you're waiting for something bad to happen.
I can remember standing in line waiting to get in, and I'm looking around. I go, I felt like one of the things on, you know, Sesame Street. One of these things just doesn't belong here. that's me. Yeah.
Now this is Detterman. Now can you imagine Detterman banging his head to this?
I was.
All quarter inch of your hair.
It was flying. It was flying. And he can also turn his head.
This is where it gets funny. This is like, who can enjoy this?
You know, actually, you know, I listen to them play. I listen to my son play, and you know, they,
right, I gotta shut that off. That's
giving
me a
headache.
And
the thing is, once they start getting into the riffs, and if you can get away from the constant beat of the you know, pounding on the drum,
yeah.
I mean, you can actually hear some good guitar work. You know, and as you said, like Megadeth, you know, Mustaine, when they get out there and start playing, I mean, it's just, you know, but you got to remember, I can remember back when I was growing up when Kiss was death metal. I mean, that was the metal. Now Kiss is what? So blasé, they're pop now?
Yeah.
they were metal back then. That was what I, you know, that was, oh my God, you're listening to Kiss? Oh, wow. You know, then all of a sudden, like, AC/DC came out, Metallica came out, and all of a sudden it was like, okay, you know, hell is broken open, and it's all broken loose here. But no, I went and watched, Megadeth and Slayer, and I had a good time. And my son's playing tonight. Good luck out there, Zach. Knithing is their name.
Nice.
If you go on Facebook, you can like their page. NITHING, Knithing.
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 That's awesome.
I thought it was just, you know, they were making fun of nothing. But he says, no, it's actually Knithing.
So, all right. So this is Megadeth. I like them in a limited fashion. This is like the one song that I like. Generation. This is like the only one that I really like. That's because of my fascination with aliens and stuff like that. So I just thought this was pretty cool. You talked about Area 51 and right. Stuff like that.
Okay. Hang on. Let's see if I can find a track from Knithing here. Here we go. Let me see. Because I had a.
Do they have stuff on YouTube? Because I'm sure I can find it.
Here you go.
Hey, give me that. Give them real play here. Let's try this again.
That's just recording off of a phone. That they did in where they practice. They practice in this really sleazy area in Cincinnati in this warehouse. He took me by and I'm going, oh, wow. You guys actually come down here at night and play? He goes, oh, yeah. He goes, when you leave, he goes, well, we left a couple times, and as you're leaving, you hear like the pop, pop, pop. He goes, okay, those are guns. Put everything in. Let's go. You go, okay.
Roll them up.
But, yeah, that's just a hit from
that
his.
That reminds me of reminds me of a scene in Kingpin where Woody Harrelson's walking up the stairs, and what's his name, Randy Quaid?
Yes,
he goes, people bowl here, they bowl here, they die here, they get their mail here. Come on, let's go.
Yes, but that was a little bit of Knithing. They're actually playing tonight. They're opening for someone, but just a brief set, and well, then they're playing again, I believe, a week from Tuesday. From Monday, week from Tuesday, somewhere in there.
Well, if they get a CD going, man, you need to give me one so we can check it out.
I think they're planning on getting it, so.
Well, there you go.
I'm looking forward to it. It should be good. Hey, did you see that? Our listeners just went through the roof listening to
that. Yeah, that was awesome.
Yeah, we went from 5 to 10 everybody. Right away.
Yeah. So,
yes.
Anyhow, now that we've completely drained 10 minutes talking about music.
We had to do something.
Yeah, well, all right. Let's get back on course for the last 15 minutes of the show here.
Yes, yes.
So, obviously, the NBA playoffs that's not the only playoffs going on right now. The NHL playoffs are happening right now. And obviously, if you're a fan of about any team in the Midwest, you don't care.
Well, no, that's not true. I mean, because St. Louis is still in it. You know, though not many people like St. Louis. I hate St. Louis.
Yeah.
Right now, I mean, your matchups in the West, you've got San Jose versus Nashville, you know, go figure, 5-6, and Stars versus Blues, 1-3.
Right.
So, you know, you have some major matchups, but, you know, both of those, they're knotted up at 2 each, you know, especially after last night. Where the Stars came back and beat the Blues 3-2 in overtime. And as I was telling you, Nashville came back and beat the Sharks 4-3 in 3 overtimes.
Right.
You know, and in hockey, I mean, 20 minutes is grueling.
Sure.
And you got 3 periods for a game. So if they played 60 minutes, they went and played, almost an additional.
Are you okay?
No, I thought something was going to drop out there. They played an additional 50 minutes before that game was. They almost had 2 full games in before that was all said and done, with the Predators pulling it out 4-3. Now, both those series are tied at 2.
Uh-huh.
So, I mean, you know, the thing is, the advantage, the Blues had taken the home ice advantage away from the Stars, but they lost it again yesterday. And the same thing to the Preds, they got it back. Right. So, I mean, you know, so, I mean, the thing is, as you take a look at this, on the West, it's pretty even. But I still believe that whoever wins the Dallas-St. Louis series is the one that's going to be representing. I think both of them can take on just their physical play and their playmakers will take on the Predators and Sharks. I've been real impressed with the way the Predators have played here in this playoffs. I mean, it's a decent team down there. This is a team that for most of the season was struggling to find themselves, and then with about 20 games left, they just went on a tear. And that's what you need when you're going into the Stanley Cup playoffs. You need to get hot at the end. And they did, and they've carried it over, and right now they're looking to get into the finals there. Now, on the other side, you know, we were talking before last week. I said, you know, I think the cream of the crop are the Washington Capitals. The Capitals now find themselves going into tomorrow's game as it's a must win. You know, the Pittsburgh Penguins are out on lead in that one, 3-1. They've just played unbelievable. But the thing about it is their goalie. This is a guy that I think he played two regular season games going to the playoffs, but due to injuries, that's where he's at. And he has just been stellar in the goal. And the Capitals just seem to have lost a lot of their, you know, a lot of their scoring. It's like they've really, you know, I think they've almost shied down from shots. Right. You know, you're used to Ovechkin getting, you know, 6-7 shots a game, 7-8. You know, Backstrom, you know, all these guys, Oshie coming in and doing that. But I mean, what they've turned into now is turned into a thug fest. And the Capitals paid the price for it a couple of the games ago when Brooks Orpik just laid out a nasty hit. I mean, it was a forearm shiver to a guy's head about 3 seconds after he got rid of the puck.
Right.
You know, and what he got was a 3-game suspension. And the thing is that, you know, the coach for Washington, they're like, what do you mean? I think we're just getting that because he hit the Penguins. No, it's because your guy's a goon. And I know I texted you after this, and Brooks Orpik, if you're unaware of him, and you were unaware of him, mm-hmm. Brooks Orpik is your goon. I mean, this is a guy that has no problem, you know, throwing out the big hit.
Yeah.
The problem is when you throw out a big hit, people are going to take exception, and you should be expected to fight. That is part of the hockey game.
Right.
Brooks Orpik is a guy that will go in and take that cheap shot, and he'll do it like this one. Shivered the guy up, knocked him flat on the ice, knocked him out cold almost. I mean, the guy was like coming off. They're helping him to the bench, and someone goes up to fight Brooks Orpik. He just, I'm not going to fight.
Yeah, he has.
He'll just say, I'm not going
to
fight.
No reason to fight.
No, and he won't. And the problem is that's such, you know, chicken crap. You know, I remember a couple years ago watching the Boston Bruins play Washington and watch Brooks Orpik do something like that. And at the time, Sean Thornton playing for the, you know, the Boston Bruins. I mean, Thornton was the enforcer. He was the guy who would go out and he would fight. Whether he wanted to fight or not, that was his job.
Right.
And he went out there to fight Brooks Orpik, and Orpik just put his hand, I'm not going to fight.
Right.
So, you know, Thornton's pissed off because, you know, you just took this cheap shot on our star player, put him out, gave him a concussion, knocked him out of the game, knocked him out for probably a couple weeks.
Mm-hmm.
So Thornton actually just went up and just started beating him. And the thing is, just, you know, beat him senseless. And the thing is Thornton's one that gets suspended for 5 games.
Which is ridiculous.
Well, it is. And the thing is that the problem is that the rules say if he's not going to fight, he's not going to fight. And, yes, you're going to get suspended. But if you take a look at the players agree. I mean, every single one that the analysts are talking about, Milbury, Roenick, they all say the same thing. He is a cheap little – I shouldn't say little because he's a big guy. But he's just a cheap, you know, crybaby, you know, hockey player. He's someone that has no respect amongst his peers. Because if you're going to do what he does, you better be able to back it up, and you better be ready to back it up if someone takes exception to it.
Right.
You know, it's like in baseball. When you throw the ball inside, if you go in and you hit the star player, you better expect your star player on your team is going to have one come inside also.
Sure, absolutely.
Well, this is one where he goes ahead and takes the hit, you know, goes and knocks this guy out, and then says, I'm not, you know, puts my hands on, I'm not going to fight. Mm-hmm. You know, what do you do? Do you fight a defense of a guy that's not going to fight you back?
I don't know.
You can understand the players of the other team.
Reasonably sure that's why they invented what's called the sucker punch.
Right. Well, you know, and that's where, you know, the thing is that's where that happened.
Yeah.
But Brooks Orpik is one they don't like. They gave him 3-game suspension. You know, and his coach is like, well, he's only getting that because it's against the Penguins. No, crap, no. It's because he's done this so many times before.
Right, right.
So, but anyways, he's out. But, you know, the Penguins themselves have played a physical game. Now, you know, give you the idea of the physicalness in this last game, you know, Ovechkin came in. You know, they're a little ticked off. They're down 3-1, or they were getting beat and made it 3-1. Came in and slashed Sidney Crosby, or Sidney Crosby had to leave the ice. You know, Crosby was ticked off going on. I mean, hockey is a very physical game, and you watch these guys go at it. I mean, you know, you're on skates, you're going at 30, 40 miles an hour, and you're wailing people up against the board. You've got that puck coming at you at 100 miles an hour.
Oh, yeah.
You got sticks in your hand. You know, hey, and it's legal. You know, it's legal to hit someone.
Right.
So
everything is a weapon in that game.
So I mean, that's a series that right now, you know, you've got Penguin up 3-1, and I think they're basically in the heads of the Capitals. And I look right now, I think, you know, at this point, the way Pittsburgh's playing, I think they can close that out. Now the other matchup in the East, you have Tampa Bay versus the New York Islanders.
Right.
And remember the Lightning last year, they made it to the Stanley Cup Finals where they lost to the Blackhawks.
Uh-huh.
You know, right now they are up on the Islanders 2-1. Tonight the Islanders on home ice, they're up 1-0. So I mean, you know, at the end of one. So this has been a very close series. You know, I again, this is one that I think whoever wins this series, I don't think that they can match the Penguins or the Capitals. But the problem is, when you got these two teams hitting each other, like the Penguins and the Capitals and the Blues and Stars, is that they really tend to beat the crap out of each other. When you get to the next series, there's kind of that letdown. You know, because the series that they were in was so, you know, emotional, was so physical, was so brutal, that you get to the next series and all of a sudden you've lost a little bit. And these other games, not that they're not as physical or whatever, it's just not as high profile as these two. So I mean, you know, right now where it's been a very even series, but you know, right, you have someone in, you have teams in there right now that if you take a look at it, the only one that I can think of that has won a Stanley Cup before are the Pittsburgh Penguins. You know, these other teams are all looking for that Stanley Cup gold.
So there's a reasonable chance we may have a brand new Stanley Cup winner.
Yeah.
So
you know, so I mean, it's just, you know, I look at this and you go, well, you know, I think Dallas won once. They may have won once.
The Stars.
Yeah, that had to be a while back. I think when I'm trying to think who was playing down there, but I don't know if Hull was playing down there or someone, but it was a long time ago. And the thing is I've lost a lot of interest in the NHL this year, mainly because the Blackhawks are out. But once you take out the Canadian teams,
right?
I mean, when you don't have the stalwarts, the original six teams in there, there's no Canadians, there's no Bruins. You know, you there's no Red Wings.
Well, a good handful of the star power.
Yeah, I mean,
gone
you,
too,
if you take out helping. Of these teams, then you take out the Kings, you take out the Ducks, and they're no longer there.
Right.
I mean, again, you know, if you take a look at the last five or six, since 2010, you had the Blackhawks, you had the Bruins, you had the Kings, the Blackhawks, the Kings, and the Blackhawks. All those teams are out.
Right.
So, I mean, you're going to have someone, you know, for the last 7 years, this is going to be a brand new one. So it's I don't know. The star power in four teams, Dallas, St. Louis, Pittsburgh, and Washington. And the problem is they're all playing each other.
Right.
So,
right.
You know, it'll be interesting. I know I'll be into it more as we get into the league championships and then also into the Stanley Cup. It'll be a little bit more interesting. Right now, you know, I've got the games on. I'm watching them and kind of looking at the paper, looking at Facebook, or doing something else at the same time.
Uh-huh.
Whereas when you get to these, you know, the original six, or when the Blackhawks are playing, or like I said, even when the Bruins are playing or Montreal's playing, you watch the whole game.
Right.
You know, now it's, you know, it's like, yeah, okay. Yeah, just tell me when we get to the championship series. Yeah, just tell me when we get to the Stanley Cup, and that's when you pick it up.
There are quite a few fans out there that are like that in a lot of sports. I know I'm usually like that in the NBA, unless there's a compelling story And there happens to be, you know, right now,
well, yeah,
a few of them. So
you're coming off a historic season for what Golden State did,
right?
And that's something that keeps people geared on that,
right?
But I think the other thing that's taking away from these sports, and I hate to say, is the Chicago Cubs.
Oh yeah,
I think they've taken a lot of luster off some of these other sports just by what they're doing.
Right, a lot of people are paying attention to baseball now.
Yes,
just simply for that. I mean, you know, how many people outside of real, you know, true blue baseball fans watch at this much baseball in May?
None, you know, so, none. Because I mean, I can remember you and I doing the show the last couple of years, and we were talking. You know, one of the best rewards you hear: pitchers and reporters. You know, pitchers and catchers report.
Yeah,
and then we got spring training start. Oh, that's great! And then opening day, fantastic! And then your comment at that point was, "Okay, I'll check back with you in August, September."
Right, exactly.
And now you're not that way.
No, now here I am in May, eating it up just like everybody else.
So I mean, I think it has made a big difference. It's made a big difference in what people are watching and what people are paying attention to.
Yeah. Closing story tonight. Just want those to you. I thought this was a neat story. J.R. Smith, he prefers a contested three-point shot. He'd rather you not leave him open.
Yes.
This is a story by Brian Windhorst from ESPN. It reads, "Perhaps the Atlanta Hawks have gone about this the wrong way. They've tried guarding J.R. Smith, but the way he shoots when guarded, well, maybe Atlanta should just leave him alone and focus on its defensive energy elsewhere. Smith has long been one of the NBA's streakiest shooters, and as part of that, one of the best bad shot makers. When Smith is running hot, and he's been lately, he knocks down shots that most players wouldn't even consider trying." And a quote from Smith says, "Guys are always looking at me like, what are you doing? What are you doing? This is my shot." So, regardless of how funny it may look to you, I feel as if I can make it when I get that opportunity. So in other words, the defense, do nothing. Yeah, he was quoted as saying, "I'd rather take a contested shot than an open shot any day. It's kind of boring when you take open shots."
Well, you know, and when I, way back when I actually played basketball, I set out and I would take the shots from way out there. When you have someone in your face or when you're getting guarded, you don't really think a lot. You just shoot.
Right, right.
But when you get the ball and there's no one there, all of a sudden you start thinking about it. And it's not an automatic. It's not something that's just by feel.
Right.
Now you're actually you've got to shoot. So I understand what he's saying. I agree with it. I'd much rather have someone there than just stand by myself.
Well, I now have his autobiography title. "Open Shots Are Boring, the J.R. Smith Story." That would be his. That is his autobiography title now.
I'd rather be with someone else.
Good.
Oh, gosh.
That was so Mother's Day.
Mother's Day. What are you doing? What are you doing?
Actually, I'm just doing a bunch of yard work.
Yep.
I got nothing going on.
I'm actually working because most of the people that work at my branch are mothers.
Right.
So I'm giving them the day off. That's
what
right.
What a guy.
That's right.
What a guy. So, they're going to do the same thing for you on Father's Day?
On Father's Day? Day? Yeah. You know, someone asked Probably me that not. Today, it and I said, working. You know, I really haven't looked at the schedule, and I know I've got to make the June schedule. I got it out, but I got to take a look at it. But I don't know.
I've always had a theory. This is by design, Mother's Day coming before Father's Day.
Well,
this was truly by design.
Well, what should?
So we butter you up all good on Mother's Day. And that way, you know, a month later when it rolls around, you go, "Oh, by the way, you remember a month ago? See ya. I'm on the golf course all weekend."
That's usually not how it works, I usually don't get that.
Usually what happens is, 30 days have passed, you forgot all about it.
No, usually it gets to Father's Day. Wouldn't today be a great day to grill? Honey, can you grill? It's Father's Day, isn't it? Shouldn't you? Oh yeah. Okay. Yeah. I'll grow.
Yeah.
You end up doing it yourself. But
yeah.
I'm not that. It doesn't bother me one way or the other.
Yeah, I'll tell you right now. You hand my wife a charcoal grill, she's gonna look at you like you're crazy. That's
I made some chicken last night that was just unbelievable.
You seriously used your grill?
I always do.
I totally did the same thing.
I did. I used my grill Tuesday night and Thursday night. Yeah.
That's hilarious. I made I actually made chicken last night too.
I had chicken breasts. I sure did.
I did something really neat. I thought it was actually pretty cool. I just kind of did the chicken up porta pit style, kind of like mock porta pit type. Yeah, yeah. Porta pit. Obviously, if you're not from this area, you know, porta pit is it's like heaven. You know, all wrapped up in chicken. It's very, very good.
But I've never heard it put quite that way.
Well, it is.
Yes.
It is. Don't argue.
But, well, you know,
but it is phenomenal. And, you know, it was actually really easy. You just take a bunch of butter, Worcestershire sauce, and red wine vinegar and just melt it all. And you make it like a liquid out of it. And while you're grilling the chicken, you're just dumping this stuff on it. It can't be good for you, but whatever.
Amazing. I just went and I got some Italian lime salad dressing.
Uh-huh.
I cut my chicken breasts up. You know, nice. I get the chicken breasts off the bone, so I cut off myself. Cut off, put it, and marinate it for about 2 hours.
Nice.
We took some fresh garlic, chopped it, you know, put it in the blender, chopped up, threw it in there with it. That sit there and soak for a little bit.
This recipe will be on Pinterest later.
Yeah, that is right. And then, you know, I do my grilling a little bit. I use charcoal. I don't know about you.
Yeah, same.
Love charcoal.
Same
charcoal. I put charcoal in the upper half of the grill on the floor.
Right.
I'll get my chicken breasts on there. I'll get them nice and brown. I used a lemon pepper seasoning.
Mm-hmm.
Lemon peppered them up. As soon as they get brown on both sides, I pull it to the other side of the grill.
Mm-hmm.
Pop the lid down. Let it sit there for about 5 or 10 minutes. Flip it over again for about 5 minutes. It's done.
Perfect.
And it is.
I use a meat thermometer.
It is perfect. It is so moist. It is so juicy. It is unbelievable.
See, I am just enough metrosexual that I have to use a meat thermometer. I cannot. I can't.
Live on the wild side, no, Mr. Willis. Come on.
No, I'm good on that.
What do you mean you can't judge it? All you got to do is cut it open. If you don't see pink, you're fine.
Yeah, see, I don't really like doing that. I don't know why. It's always been one of those weird things to me, like, oh, well, I cut it open. Well, I ruined that piece now.
No. See, I know, you know, after doing it so long, you know how long it is. And you know by picking it up with the tongs, mm-hmm. you can feel.
I have a good general idea. Like a steak, I can do a steak and not even think about it.
Yeah.
I can do a steak and not even think about it. Chicken is kind of new for me on the grill.
Chicken's fun. You know, long time ago, I was the guy that would burn it on the grill. You know, you get the flames flowing all the I've learned to use the half of the grill.
I can't believe you've never done that before, like from the very beginning.
No, I didn't. I would have right in the middle, and you do it, and you push off
God,
the side.
Oh, God, yeah, you never do that.
Yeah, well, I used to way back when.
Really?
But I could get it to work real well.
Yeah, the only time you do that is if you want to, like, super cook hot dogs or something.
Right.
To completely blow them up.
I use that, and now I'm getting to the point of, you know, using the little chips. The little mesquite chips and everything else.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I actually turned mine into a smoker one time.
Did you really?
Pretty neat. Yeah. Yeah. I'll show you how to do it one time.
Okay. Sounds good.
With that, it's time we got to get out of here.
We've finished off our food segment now.
Yeah.
Okay. We've covered everything we could possibly cover.
Yes. The ADD segment of this show. For transcripts of tonight's show, please send $1.
Please don't even worry about it because it's all over the board.
It truly is.
Can we actually put this under as a sports show today?
I don't know.
It might be there.
It's going to be a sports show.
I think we opened with the Cubs. Yes, we did. We covered a lot of sports today.
We covered everything.
We did. We went from baseball to basketball to hockey to MMA to boxing to the Kentucky Derby to wrestling. Yeah. We talked about Daytona. We talked about the Indy 500. We talked about fantasy games.
Yeah.
We mentioned MLS and the World Cup.
Yeah.
We talked about the Olympics.
Yeah.
What the hell?
I hate us right now because guess who gets to write the bio on Spreaker?
You do. Yeah, me. And I'm waiting for when you put this up to actually see how you term this one.
Yeah, the word et cetera, I think, is coming in there somewhere.
There you go. Steven C., this is our sports et cetera show. There you go. Book it.
Yep, there we go. Enjoy the Kentucky Derby tomorrow. Enjoy Mother's Day. All you moms out there.
All you mothers.
Good job. And for all of you that are going to become mothers, like a few friends of mine, good job. No, one of my best friends.
Okay.
One of my best friends, his wife is expecting their second child.
I know some mothers out there that aren't even women, so that's another thing. They're just mothers.
This is true.
Yes. Okay. But hey, happy Mother's Day to all of you out there. Enjoy.
And you guys have a good weekend.
Bye.
You gotta do some wrong. Got hella shit going on.
What else?
The dusty.
That's the dirty.
You're listening to XCRS Radio, bringing you classic rock live.